You're watching South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Today's South Dakota adventure takes us to the windswept Badlands. This eerie, almost lunar landscape is rich in legend. Somewhere out there between the Badlands and Wounded Knee Creek to the south, a great leader of the Sioux Nation is in his final resting place. Crazy Horse was secretly buried here by his father, and to this day, the site remains a secret. But what's drawn us here is something Crazy Horse said. When asked where his people called home, Crazy Horse replied, "My lands are where my dead lie buried." And today, that means any of the 7 Indian reservations in South Dakota. How did this corner of Dakota Territory become the home of a proud and free-roaming tribe? Well, that's today's South Dakota adventure. By the time George Washington was president, 4 million people were living on land that once had been the exclusive home of the Native American. Land-hungry and power-hungry people saw the riches of America and were determined to exploit it. What happened to the Native Americans during the 500 years between the time of Columbus and today? From the time Columbus kidnapped 10 of his friendly Indian hosts and carried them back to Spain until the last Indian was settled on a reservation, struggles between white and red men were constant. Now, we're all familiar with the story of the Pilgrims and how the Native American Indians welcomed the first white settlers to the continent. The Indians taught the colonists how to build fish traps, raise corn, and stalk game. Our Thanksgiving holiday of friendship and celebration originates with the feast of these pilgrims and Native Americans. Most stories are not so pleasant. When the colonists were starving at Jamestown, Virginia, they received no help. Battles were constant. As more settlers arrived and spread out over the land, the Indians became alarmed. As the white men settled the land, most of the tribes were moved to the western lands. The Sioux tribe had been forced into Wisconsin, Minnesota, and Dakota Territory. Meanwhile, more than 5 million new settlers had come to the United States in 30 years. Where were these people to go? Many had come from countries that had no room for them. Exciting events were beginning to lure more white adventurers into lands that were sacredly promised to the Sioux people forever. Gold had been discovered in California, and later in Colorado and Montana. While some gold seekers sailed around South America to reach the West Coast, hordes of others packed their mules, loaded their wagons, and took a shortcut across Indian land in South Dakota. Eventually, the Indians were forced off the vast plains and into sections of land called reservations. Now, these were the areas reserved for Indians who were in the way of the white man's progress. The white leaders hoped Indian families would settle down and become farmers. Greed for land and gold and control of the country drove the white men further and further west. Young warriors, quick to defend their people, could not be kept from attacking the wagon trains, the soldiers, and the settlers. New states were being created out of the land west of the Mississippi, and men dreamed of a country from sea to shining sea. Roads and railroads must be built. Red Cloud, a very proud and powerful Oglala Teton leader, said, "The white man was raised over the great waters, and his land is over there. Since they crossed the sea, I have given them room. I have but a small spot of land left. The Great Spirit told me to keep it." Red Cloud, Crazy Horse, and thousands of followers watched as the trails and roads stretched ever westward. Forts were being built along the way. The Indian people watched as the white men blazed trails through their territory. When Red Cloud met with the commission from Washington to talk about treaties, he scolded them. White chief goes with soldiers to steal road before Indian says yes or no. Red Cloud was determined the forts must be taken down. Red Cloud and Crazy Horse found ways to convince the soldiers they must leave. At one time, the warriors planned a surprise attack by stampeding 175 horses just outside the fort. The soldiers were lured out, Red Cloud attacked. Next, the warriors attacked a wagon train directed to get a supply of firewood outside the fort. All 81 of Captain Fetterman's command were killed. The white people were furious about the defeat and called the battle Fetterman's Massacre. The Indians named it the Battle of the Hundred Slain because at least 200 warriors were killed or wounded. Red Cloud would not give up. Until the government abandoned the forts and stopped using the Bozeman Trail, no treaty would be signed. The forts were destroyed, and in 1868, Red Cloud went to Fort Laramie in Wyoming to sign the treaty. In essence, the treaty was a promise. It said no white person or persons shall be permitted to settle upon or occupy any portion of the territory without the consent of the Indians to pass through the same. Crazy Horse read that and said, "One does not sell the earth upon which the people walk." But for a while, Red Cloud, Spotted Tail, and other leaders settled with their people on the reservations, but not for long. Rumors of gold lured white miners to the Black Hills, and the army couldn't stop them. So 4 years after the treaty was signed, it was unenforceable. So the army was ordered to settle the gold rumors once and for all. A unit was sent from Fort Abraham Lincoln to explore for gold in the Black Hills. The unit was led by a young officer, George Armstrong Custer. Red Cloud and the angry young warriors watched the army march, but they were not prepared to attack Custer. Custer circled the hills and marched safely back to Fort Abraham Lincoln with the news of gold in the Black Hills. Gold seekers poured into the sacred hills of the Sioux. For a while, the soldiers turned them back, but there were so many people sneaking into the hills that the government decided they should try a different approach. Commissioners again came from Washington, D.C. to make another treaty. They hoped to buy or at least lease the Black Hills. Sitting Bull was very angry. "We want no white men here. The Black Hills belong to me. If the white men try to take them, I will fight." By the time of the treaty meeting, the plains were covered with Sioux camps and grazing ponies. More than 20,000 Indians waited to see what the treaty makers would do. The meeting ended with the Sioux agreeing among themselves to never lease or sell the Black Hills. Well, after the commissioners returned to Washington, they offered a price for the hills and chose to believe the affair had been settled. Most of the tribes had gone off to the Powder River country to hunt and consider what they might do. White leaders became concerned that the Indians were preparing for war. An order went out that every Indian person must be on a reservation by January 31st, 1876. Otherwise, the soldiers would act. Because the camps could not be broken up in the winter months for such a long march, the people ignored the command, or they just didn't learn about it, and the soldiers began their pursuit. Best known of all the battles was the one fought near the Little Bighorn River in Montana. General George Armstrong Custer was in command. Another army was moving from the north, and a third from the west. General Crook was marching northwest along the Bozeman Trail. The white armies planned to surround the Indians. During the week between June 17th and June 25th, 1876, the armies were on the move. Many accounts are given about how General Custer, Captain Benteen, and Major Reno laid their plans, divided their troops, and moved towards their enemies. On June 25th, 1876, General Custer decided to attack with his 225 men one day earlier than the agreement. Unexpectedly, he was surrounded by a strong force of warriors who left not a single white soldier alive on the battlefield. Because no soldier was left alive, many myths have been told. When the news of Custer's death and the loss of the American soldiers reached the people, they were beginning to celebrate the country's 100th birthday. It was July 4th, 1876. The disaster stirred bitter feelings and hatred for the Indians. Congress now insisted the Black Hills be turned over to the white men. Sitting Bull, who was now the most respected leader, fled with his Hunk Papa followers to Canada and asked for shelter. But the Canadian government turned them away. 4 years later, the starving tribe surrendered. Sitting Bull became a prisoner at Fort Randall. The white men tried to win Sitting Bull over to their side, but he did not change. He was released and encouraged to give speeches as he was taken on tours around the country. Buffalo Bill, added Sitting Bull to his famous Wild West show. At the end of the tour, Sitting Bull returned to the Standing Rock Reservation with two gifts from Buffalo Bill, a huge white sombrero and a performing horse trained to sit down and raise one hoof at the crack of a gunshot. By forcing all the Indians to live on six reservations in South Dakota, the commissioners gained control over 9 million acres of Indian land. By this means, the freed land could be sold to the thousands of immigrants. The Sioux had deep feelings about what had happened to them. Few white men seemed to understand how they felt about their religion, their love of the land, or their way of life. The Sioux people had always been wanderers. No Indian man could possibly have good feelings about being a farmer. Besides, the soil on the reservations was poor. Little rain fell, and hot winds and drought caused the crops to fail. The government offered fewer and fewer rations to force the people to take care of themselves. About this time, a law was passed dividing the land into smaller sections called allotments. They might be like today's family farm. But the problem was, at no time had the Indian people lived this way. They lived in clusters in the extended family, the Taoshpe. The old way of Indian life would soon be gone. Forever? Well, not exactly, but that's our next South Dakota adventure.